I'm going to now call on Stephanie to come forward and bring a eulogy for her dad, and then also I believe Anton is also going to come and share something with us. You're welcome to come up to the pulpit and use it for your notes, or you can stand down there. Die vroeë oggendure saam met die oupa in die plaas kom wys
mis met die houtstoof wat die hele kombuis warm maak, die reuk van koffie en varsmelk, die klank van Harry's geel op die radio en Hansie die Jack Russell wat altyd op die stoel langs die houtstoof gelê het en gebak het. Die meeste van my tyd saam met my oupa was toe ek baie jonk was en dit breek my hart dat ek nie meer tyd saam met hom kan spandeer nie. Maar die tyd wat ek wel saam met hom deurgebring het, is vir my uiters kosbaar en ek het tot vandag toe lewenslesse van hom geleer wat ek nooit sal vergeet nie. Mag jy sannies rus, my oupa. Dankie vir alles wat jy vir my beteken het. Dankie vir die pa wat jy was vir my pa, Johan, en die man en vir my ouma, Veronica. Dankie dat jy Abby, my verloofde, met oop arms aanvaar het en haar soos jou eie kleinkind laat voel het. Tot ons weer ontmoet. Liefde, Gustav. Daniel, oupa Klaas, een man van min woorde, maar met baie wysheid. Ek sal oupa altyd onthou as 'n man wat sy alles gegee het vir sy familie. Ek sal onthou hoe hy in die oggend langs die houtstoof gesit het. Dit was sy plekkie gewees met Hansie op sy skoot. Hy het elke oggend seker gemaak daar is vars melk vir ontbyt en ek sal onthou dat Brakkies en Heidi sy hele lewe was. Ma wou nie Brakkies en Heidi kerk toe bring. Oupa Klaas se teenwoordigheid sal gemis word, maar sy gees sal vir ewig by ons wees. Karen, dit alles was pa se karakter. Hy het die vrug van die gees gedra, liefde, vreugde, vrede, geduld, vriendelikheid, goedhartigheid, getrouheid, nederigheid en selfbeheersing. Wat 'n eer was dit om pa as my pa te kon hê. Pa los 'n leemte, maar ek gun pa die rus. Baie liefde, Karen. Johan. Is dit nie maar net in dankbaarheid dat ons so vol lewe kan vier nie? Ek weet sonder 'n ander helfte soos ons moeder, sou dit glad nie moontlik gewees het nie. Dankie moeder. Die woord sê dat ons deur ons woorde geoordeel sal word en daar was so waar nie 'n man van baie woorde nie. Behalwe natuurlik op dipdag daar in die kloof op groot woord. Ek weet nie hoeveel van ons dit ervaar het nie. Dan was dit nie net woorde nie. Sommer die sweep, die kierie en klippe en baie ander woorde. Ek kon nie verstaan dat een stomme dier hom so kwaad kon maak. Met sy roer was hy een boer, kon een duiker oor die voetpad plat trek met een skoot, met sy ouderlingskap een voorbeeld vir baie. Sal nooit lees en bid en alle vergeet nie, al het party woorde net hier en daar postgevat. The Lord your God is with you, He is mighty to save. He will take great delight in you. He will quiet you in his love. Dad was 'n padmaker en later 'n volwaardige houtkapper, waarvan niemand in die hele wêreld so skerp byl gehad het nie. Daai ding was gevaarlik. Ons mag nie van die kernekampe so triple SX mask geraak het nie. Pa het dit by die kernekamp as 'n winkel gekoop. Ek dink daar was 5 pakkies sweets wat elke maand ons bederf was. Ek dink dit was elke maand op skuld gekoop. Kan egter verkeerd wees. Ek weet nie, ma, was dit? Pen en papier is nie maklik om 'n leeftyd te vier nie. Dad moet lekker rus en groete sê vir die diepkoestel. Hulle sit nou seker en dan word speel met hom. Dan sê hy, the Lord is faithful to all his promises and loving to what all he has made. Nou is het my boodskap, dat hy net ons gebid. Hy het ons aan die slaap gebid. Ek sal dit nooit vergeet nie. En dan hier iewers in die middernagtelike ure het hy ons uitgehaal uit daai bed uit. En ons laat ja, ek weet nie of julle dit ken nie. Daai dat jare later toe dit my beurt was om die middernagkers te brand om die hoërskool te kom, het pa my vroegdag saggies met 'n beker koffie kom wakker maak, nodeloos om te sê hy het my net in bed gekry. Pa se hart was altyd op die plaas en ek is baie dankbaar dat ek daar kaalvoet in die veld tussen diere en in stilte kon groot word. Pa was 'n mens van min woorde. Hy het net gepraat as hy rarig moes. Pa het nie sommer gewys dat hy ongekrap of kwaad is nie. Pa was lankmoedig. Pa het geglo dat God sal voorsien en ek glo ook so. Pa het altyd maar net gedoen wat gedoen moes word. Wanneer dinge erg verkeerd loop, het hy altyd bly hoop. Pa het ook nie geweet hoe om met geld te werk nie. Wat inkom, moet uit. Ek is ook so. Ma het altyd gesê, ek is nes met pa. Hier is ons sien geen gevaar in die situasie en ons beskerm engele en werkwoorde. Wanneer ek pa gegroet het, het pa gesig. Dis maar swaar. Dan vra, hoe gaan dit met pa se swaar? Dan het ek nou uitgevra na al die familie en wanneer laas hy gehoor het van die ene en daai. Pa se swaar kry daar is nou vir ewig verby. Een van die laaste kere wat ek hom hoor praat het, het hy gesê, wanneer gaan hierdie lyding ophou? Toe sê ek, hoe pa net vasthou. Ook iets wat hy vir my, een van die eerste dinge wat hy gesê het is, hy sê, ek het jou geroep en jy het nie geantwoord nie. En ek het vir Gustav geroep en hy het ver langs geantwoord. So, pa, God droog al die trane op. Geen meer onrus, geen meer pyn. Ek gun vir die ewige lewe by ons verlosser en koning. Tom, daar is 'n leeu plek aan ons tafel, wanneer ons 'n vleisie braai en medisyne saam geniet. Die lyding en swaar kres verby. Die einde van 'n era, rustig. Ma, moeder, dit was nie 'n maklike 60 jaar nie, maar ons wil uit ons harte uit sê, dankie dat ma volhard het en vir ons pa tot in sy laaste asem gesorg het. Mag die Here ons seën. Dankie.
Fisies, ek praat van fisies werk. Daar is nie 'n mens wat Stephanie gelees het nou of ons hier voorgedra het by die kinders en die kleinkinders sê ek beaam dit alles, ek beaam dit alles. Ek wil ook net sê dat hy ten spyte van dat hy 'n goeie mens was en 'n rustige mens, niemand het op hom getrap. Hy het nie op hom laat trap. Hy het gestaan by sy punte en ek weet, daar een van die kinders het ook gesê daar dat hy kon skiet met 'n geweerkraai. Ek het gesien dat hy 'n haas omtrent op 300 meter, 'n haas met een skoot skiet. Nee, hy kon skiet. En soos my neef wat nou hier op saam met my is, sal weet hoe ons hy om jou daar onder in Guava in die lande gewerk het. Maar alleen met 'n pik het hy op milie land geskoffel. Ons het nog afgegaan daarom toe, dit was warm. Ek het in my lewe nie so warm gekry. Daar het ou Jot gekap met 'n pik. Hy het milies geskoffel met 'n pik. Hy het gekom, hy het op die pad gewerk soos hulle gesê het, hy was die pad kreider operator gewees. Dan kom hy, dan werk hy heel dag. Dan kom hy vanaand by die huis. Dan is hy op die trekker, as daar nou ploegtyd en saaityd, dan gaan werk hy. Dan kom hy môreoggend 1-2 kom hy terug. En so het hy dan nou ook bewys hier net hoe hard hy gewerk. Hy het nog steeds gehoor en hy het gewerk en met hy twee dae hout gekap het hy. Elke stukkie hout met 'n byl gekap. Elke stukkie hout het hy met 'n byl gekap. Nee, ons is hy was 'n goeie mens. Hy was goed vir sy familie. Hy het hard gewerk, soos die getuienis gehoor het van die kinders se boodskap. En in elk geval,
why don't you join me once again in a word of prayer? Our Father, as we bow our heads before you, we would bring the Woodendahl family before you. Father, we just ask as we've heard the stories, as we've heard the memories, Lord, our prayer is for each one who is mourning this morning. Lord, that you'd come alongside them. Lord, that you'd uplift them. Father, that you'd take them in your hands and give them the comfort that they need. And Father, we thank you too for the reminders of just what an incredible child of yours were your thoughts. The way he loved you. The way he was true to your word. The way he followed you. The way he taught his family to follow you. And Father, we thank you this morning again that we have this certainty of where he is now. He's no longer with us, but he is with you. He has heard those words, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." And now he is enjoying the rest which you have given to him. Holy Spirit, we ask, won't you use these thoughts, won't you use this reality to give us strength, to encourage us, but also to challenge us in our own relationship to you. And now, Father, as we turn to your word, we ask that you speak into our hearts. Won't you encourage us? Won't you challenge us? Holy Spirit, may you help each one of us to ensure we know what we should know. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, I met with Auntie Veronica and Stephanie this past week, and we chatted about this morning and what we should do and what we should be dealing with, and the one thing that came out very clearly is that it needs to be short and simple. No airs and graces, no funny business, no big things. And one of the things that Stephanie and Auntie
Veronica said to me was that Mjot was busy reading a book, and so they gave me the two pages on which he had stopped and where he was busy reading, and they asked me if I wouldn't mind basing my message this morning on this, and so I've done just that. And as they said to me, and as I see as I read this, just how apt it is for the service this morning and for what we're talking about. Maar ek wil net een ding sê, en dis die laaste wat ek Afrikaans kan praat, want ek sal vir julle sê, Afrikaans is nie te goed nie, my woordeskat is een bietjie klein, maar die is in Afrikaans geskryf. En wat dit erger gemaakt is, is dat dit baie theologische woorde in het het.
Did Google not help you?
Ek dink ek het dit gekry. Ek dink ek het
you got my number.
Ek dink ek het die kern van die stuk gekry en daai woord het ek opgekyk. There are three points in these pages that I want to share with you this morning. But before I get to those three points, I'd like to read to you from Ecclesiastes chapter 3. Because the basic overview of what is being said really comes through in Ecclesiastes, but then also the main passage I want to deal with is from James chapter 4. But just Ecclesiastes chapter 3, that very, very well-known passage, which says there is a time for everything and a season for every activity under heaven. There is a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to uproot, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to scatter stones and a time to gather them, a time to embrace and a time to refrain, a time to search, and a time to give up, a time to keep, and a time to throw away, a time to tear, and a time to mend, a time to be silent, and a time to speak, a time to love, and a time to hate, a time for war, and a time for peace. Time is the one thing that we all want more of, but at the same time, it's the one thing we wish would hurry up. It's the one thing we want to last longer, and it's the one thing we want to get over with. With the understanding of a time for every purpose under heaven, listen to James as he writes his letter in chapter 4, verses 13 to 17. Now listen, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go to this or that city, spend a year there, carry on business and make money. Why? You don't even know what will happen tomorrow. What is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if it is the Lord's will, we will live and do this or that. As it is, you boast and brag. All such boasting is evil. Anyone then who knows the good he ought to do and doesn't do it, sins. Now to those three points that Mjot was reading in his last days. The three points are quite simple. Time is short. The second point is God the Creator is Lord of time. The last point is, because time is short and our end is inevitable, don't waste any time in making sure of your calling and your election. But let's go back and let's start with this idea that time is short. No matter how much time we have in this life, we never truly seem to have enough of it. It's that whole idea of we need more time, but we wish time would hurry up. The reality of life is when we look again, time is gone. It's the 8th of June, middle of
about 14 days away. Can you believe that? This year is half gone. That's the reality of time. When we look again, it's gone. Even our lives, when you think of the lives that we live today, in the grand scheme of history, we're not here for very long. Scripture says we are given 70 years, more, as the Lord has blessing to our lives. But what is 70 years in the light of history? If you believe Scripture, this world has been around for about 7,000 years. If you listen to the scientists, they say billions of years. Either way, 70 years is such a small fraction of human existence. And this is a concept we must embrace, not fear. This is one of many parts of life that we have no control over. How long our life is out of our hands. We don't control that. We can't decide when we're going to be born, and we certainly don't decide when we're going to die. We only have one life to live. And before you can say or even think anything of substance, it's over. Time is short. The second point this morning is this idea that God is our creator and he is the Lord of time. And for you and I, we can't do anything about how much time we have. In fact, Jesus, in one of the times he spoke to those around him, he made the point that we cannot add a single moment to our lives. He was talking about this idea of worry. He was saying to the people, doesn't matter how much you worry, you can't add a single minute to your life. And I would argue, worrying will actually shorten your life. As you put stress on your body and you add all this extra stuff into your life. There is nothing we can do to extend it. But there is one person for whom this is not an issue. There is one person for whom time means absolutely nothing. You see, when it comes to God, he is the creator, not only of this world, but he is the creator of time. Before God said, let there be light, there was nothing but God. No time, no space, and no matter. God created time, and he is Lord of it. He's in control of it. He has it in his hands. In Scripture, we have seen God stop time. Joshua chapter 10, as the sun stops, as Joshua prays and asks the Lord to give them more time, the sun stops right where it is until the battle is over. We've seen God turning time backwards. In 2 Kings chapter 20, we see the shadow going back up the staircase. As God turns time backwards. We may not have any control over time, but God does. Because he is God, he can do what he wants when he wants to. And he can do what he wants to with time as well. But for you and I, we're very different. We don't have control over time as he does. And so we must be sure not to waste any of the time God gives us. The time God gives us is a gift.